we were signed 6 months after our first gig. So, like, we didn't get a chance to be part of this scene because we were already at Geffen Records in New York recording an album with Jimmy Iovine. You know, it was like, boom, we were out of there. That was that. We sold out so quick.
We sold out. How old were you then, actually? When
I was 18.
Uh-huh. Can you take the guitar and sort of demonstrate what the style was sort of like in those days? Or that sort of country?
Let me see. Where's the pick? Where's the pick? I need a pick. Is there a pick around? We used to play around, and for some reason word got out and all these famous people started coming to see us play. Like Dolly Parton came one night, and I was talking about John Doe earlier, I'll never forget. He grabbed me by the scruff of my neck one night at one of my gigs, and he said, "Look, don't believe the hype. You listen to me when I'm talking to you. If you turn into an asshole, I'm gonna beat your ass." And I was like, fuck you, man, you know, because I was like 18 and I didn't want to hear it, you know. And geez, I should have listened to that, you know, because.
Yeah. You did believe the hype.
It's when you're 18 years old and Dolly Parton comes down to see you play in some, you know, club and sits in the front row and starts screaming and hollering at you.
And this is when you just had your first long distance record out, I guess.
No, it was before we even had a record out. We were just about, you know, there was like a bidding war, and we had to like choose which label we were gonna sign with. So we signed with Geffen, and that was, you know, and then everything sort of changed.
I talked to a promoter right after that first record was out, and he said, you know, that this contract that you had signed with Long Distance with Geffen was going to put so much pressure on the band, and because the first album didn't sell as well as they had expected.
It was just an absolute free-for-all. You can't even imagine what sort of bloodbath it was. I mean, never in rock and roll history. the band just went poof. We were out on tour, people were being fired, like behind my back. People were told they couldn't write songs anymore for the band. I was told I had to work with this person, that person, you're too fat, you're too this, whatever. Write songs with this guy, write songs with that guy. So-and-so is going to produce your record. This is what you got to sound like. This is what you got to look like. It was literally like, you know, the ultimate cliche, you know. There you go. I just broke my pick. And I was trying really hard to please Jimmy Iovine, who was my manager and my producer, and I just wanted to be the girl that he wanted me to be. I wanted to be the female Bruce Springsteen, really bad for him, you know? And so I tried everything. Tried everything. And nothing worked because I was miserable. So, and I didn't realize that I was this person who had all this music inside of them. And it's so evident when I would walk out onto a stage and perform. It was all there.
Yeah.
All my references and all the records I'd listened to, from Edith Piaf to Patti Smith to Tom Waits to, you know, Bill Monroe to Howlin' Wolf to, you know, Stephen Sondheim. It was all inside here. And when I would perform, a lot of times I would feel the stuff welling up inside of me, but whenever I'd go into the studio to make a record, there'd always be these bozos hanging around who would tell me, you know, whatever, that's fine for that, and you can do that at home, and you can leave that record at home, thank you very much. But, you know, when it's time for you to make a record, nobody wants to know about that. Trust me, you know. Very easy to be influenced. And there are certain people in this business who make it a point to introduce a young artist to, it's similar to people who turn young kids onto drugs. I mean, they turn you onto fame and money. They give you backstage passes and they introduce you to famous people and they have you around, you know, they give you a taste, they whet your appetite for fame and money and success, mm-hmm. you know, so that you're putty in their hands. People like that are really, Dave Stewart, Annie Lennox, Bruce Springsteen, Bono, Steve Van Zandt. I mean, they tried every combination of people and influences to try to get Lone Justice to happen big. Every, you know, didn't leave one stone unturned. Bob Dylan wrote a song for the record. I mean, if Bob Dylan writes a song for the record and you still don't have a hit record, then maybe, you know, you've tried everything.
Yeah.
Short of, I don't know what, Jim Steinman and Meatloaf doing a duet. I mean, I don't know what's left after that. What's left? You know, get the Beatles back together to back you up. I mean, I don't know what's...